All right, and we back on the forecast. Now, we as a community need to do more than just pay attention to history and notice the cycles. We need to start taking actions on those cycles. And the theme of America has always been black destruction, not only physically and mentally, but also sexually. One of the most dangerous groups in America is by far the white woman, because white women have learned how to play the fence. I have no idea how white women are considered a minority when they're the majority of the population in the voter bloc. But they managed to play both sides of the fence. They benefited the most from the civil rights movement, all while helping maintain white supremacy. From the early white feminists like Margaret Sanger, who talked about eugenics, to the second wave feminism in the 60s and 70s that was used to break up the black family, to feminism today in the Me Too witch hunt, or should I say black male hunt. But you'll never hear feminist organizations talk about women like Mary Zolkowski, who looked like she could be a feminist herself. In Michigan, this white girl, Mary Zolkowski, was charged with lying about being raped by a black man.
A woman has now been sent to jail for 45 days for making up a story about being raped by a black man in a Delta College parking lot. I'm talking about 21-year-old Mary Zolkowski, who's been sentenced to not only those 45 days in jail, but also 2 years of probation with 220 days of deferred jail, meaning if she violates probation, she would have to serve 220 additional days. And as we now understand the story, Zolkowski says she was previously sexually assaulted, not anybody on the Delta College campus, not a black guy, but that she was ashamed to come forward initially and ended up apparently projecting a prior sexual assault onto a vague black man on the college campus. It now is unclear whether she was even actually sexually assaulted prior to the accusation of rape that she made against this amorphous black man on the Delta College campus. Police heard her story originally, started investigating it, and found absolutely no evidence whatsoever. They actually did find a black guy with a criminal record on the Delta College campus, brought him in for a polygraph test, which the guy passed, and ultimately Zolkowski admitted to police that the story is not true. This has to be taken very seriously. And if there's any argument to be made, it's that 45 days isn't enough. And the reason why I think it may not be enough is that the person who could have ended up in prison based on the false rape claim could have gotten 20 years in prison. Wow. And the only case for 45 days instead of more for this woman would be that, number one, as prescribed by the law, the max she could have gotten was 6 months for false reporting of a felony. That's how the law is currently written. And number two, her lawyer said that she suffers from bipolar disorder. And I am 100% sensitive to the impact of mental illness on behavior.
Now, this girl, Mary Zolkowski, claimed that this big black man jumped out of nowhere and raped her. Initially, she said she was walking to her car in a back parking lot when a man grabbed her from behind, grabbed her face, grabbed her throat, and proceeded to rape her without a condom. She said when it was over, he took off and jumped into a passenger seat of a car. And it was so fast, she couldn't really get a description of him. All she knew was he was a black man. Now, when the police tried to investigate, she refused to get a physical exam. They even arrested a random black dude and started questioning him about the rape. If this was 1918 and that was his grandfather, they probably would have hung him. But luckily, in this case, the police decided to do more than just take this white girl's word for it. Then when the police talked to her again, she changed her story and said, well, it wasn't this black dude. It was this guy I already knew. But he had text messages from her claiming that she was raped by somebody in a Walmart parking lot. Eventually, she did take a plea deal. And at first, Judge Joseph Sheeran said he wasn't going to give her any jail time, just probation. He ended up sentencing her to 45 days. With 220 days over her head if she violate probation. White women have gotten whole towns destroyed. Men, women, and children based off allegations that 50 years or 100 years later we find out wasn't true at all. That white woman Carolyn Bryant can admit to lying about Emmett Till all those years later and they still won't do anything to her, even though it's no statute of limitation on murder. And if a black man did rape this white girl, Mary Zolkowski, even though I don't see why any black man would, he'd probably never get out of jail. until black men and white women and everybody in between is treated equally in the justice system, then we have a problem. But they'll never give a white girl the same time they'll give a black man. You have cases like Gregory Counts and Van Dyke Perry. They were falsely accused of rape and convicted.
But they just kept going on. It's like a locomotive train that was going full throttle.
Gregory Counts and Van Dyke Perry.
Yeah, I got a lot to talk about. I got like 20, almost 30 years to talk about.
We're in court for the first time since 1991 where they actually got justice.
These two men were convicted of kidnapping, rape, and sodomy because of the testimony of a complainant who recanted her accusations just 2 weeks ago.
Manhattan District Attorney Cy Vance talks about the case of the two men that his office worked with Barry Scheck's Innocence Project and state appellate attorneys to get reversed. Counts and Perry were accused by a woman in Harlem of violently raping her while they drove around in a car back in 1991. Despite DNA evidence produced that pointed to someone else and firm alibis from the two men and inconsistent testimony from the accuser and the car in which the alleged sex crime took place having been broken down at the time, the men were convicted. Perry served a dozen years, Counts 27.
And during that time, I prayed for my life. And I was young. I'm scared to death. I don't know what's going on.
Perry moved to the Pacific Northwest to try and start a new life.
When I was living in the car, I was living in my car with my kids and my wife.
The judge vacated their convictions at last. Now men with records that are clean from a crime that didn't exist say they'll try to live as normal lives as possible.
I can't live off hate. Nobody can live off hate. You know, like I just said earlier inside the courthouse, if I could waste 10 minutes being angry, why can't I waste 10 minutes being happy? I'd rather be 10 minutes happy than 10 minutes angry.
Yeah, hey, I'm not staying in New York no more. They railroaded me for a crime I ain't do. No, I ain't staying out.
Many states do not provide compensation if someone has been wrongfully convicted and incarcerated. New York is not one of those states. You can get compensated for wrongful conviction. Both men intend to pursue that as well as civil cases.
In this case, two black men were convicted. Even though the DNA did not match them and matched up to somebody else, even though they had solid alibis, even though the story from the accuser was inconsistent, even the car she claimed they raped her in was broken down at the time, the state didn't care and they convicted him anyway. Van Dyke Perry ended up doing 10 years and Gregory Counts ended up doing 26 years for a rape he did not commit. And the court didn't care about the truth. And after they served their time, then the woman recanted her story. And after their lives were already ruined, then they were finally exonerated. It's not about fairness or justice. Meanwhile, you have cases like Alec Cook. He admitted to raping at least three women and stalking another two. And he was only given 3 years in jail.
I'm sorry. I was wrong.
A former college student convicted of sexual assault breaks down in tears during his sentencing. 22-year-old Alec Cook had pled guilty to sexually assaulting three women and choking or stalking two others while a student at the University of Wisconsin.
You told the truth and everyone should believe you. This is my fault.
One of his victims, who didn't want her face to be shown, spoke about her horror.
In some ways, this entire experience has made me forget how to be kind to myself and how to trust myself.
The judge also got emotional as he responded to her victim impact statement.
Please continue to be kind. I'm sorry, and positive, and don't let him take that from you.
Not only did he go to great lengths to let people know that he was following the law, he also reached out specifically to the victims to let them know their voices were being recognized.
Cook looks dramatically different now than when he was arrested in October 2016. A diary was discovered that contained names of women he was interested in. It lists things like job/major, what makes her special, what's my next step, has it come to an end, and this eerie notation, killed next to an unchecked box. The prosecutor says the diary is evidence of stalking and grooming. When the story first broke, Cook's high school prom date, Megan Couture, spoke exclusively to Inside Edition.
He threw me on a pool table.
Were you afraid of him?
Yeah, I mean, he's really, like, he's a big person. Like, I'm 5'2", and he's well above 6 foot, and, like, he's just big and powerful.
Back in high school, he was known as Mr. Fingers.
He made sexual advances on my friend where he was just trying to, they were hanging out in her basement, and he would just, like, try and stick his hand down her pants, like, repeatedly while she didn't want to.
Though he faced a maximum sentence of 19 years, Cook was sentenced to only 3 years behind bars, partly because the judge took into account he did not have any prior criminal history.
Would you say there's outrage over him just getting 3 years?
Oh, absolutely. People look at the conduct committed here and say, wait a minute, is this enough of a punishment?
Now, this psychopath, Alec Cook, had a diary with detailed information about the women he wanted to rape and how to do it, and whether he would kill them or not. He was facing 19 years, but the judge, Stephen Ehlke, showed him some leniency and only gave him 3 years. This judge gave him credit for not having a prior record. But in America, it's easy for white people not to have a prior record. That's a part of the white privilege. He admitted to raping 3 women and stalking another 2, but since he didn't have any priors, it's okay. But this same judge, Stephen Ehlke, gave a black man guilty of sexually assaulting 1 woman 20 years. And to excuse the racial disparity, they'll try to say, well, it's about money, not about race, as if there isn't a racial disparity in wealth. But it's not about money. Poor white men can get away with what rich black men can't get away with. In Montana, a man admitted to raping his 12-year-old daughter for years. The judge, John McKeon, sentenced him to 60 days with 17 suspended, so he only had to do 43 days. The girl's mother even asked the judge not to send him to jail. And it wasn't because he had money, because he didn't. Because it has nothing to do with wealth. They fear the big bad black man. Yet we constantly excuse it and cape for him. At some point, we gotta realize these people don't have our best interests at heart. And we all we got. When black men and women came together and worked together, we actually made something happen. But if we stay divided, we'll continue to lose.
And Dyke Perry and Gregory Counts couldn't hold back the emotion and tears as they sat in a Manhattan courtroom today, finally exonerated of a crime they were accused of in 1991.
These 2 men were convicted of kidnapping, rape, and sodomy because of the testimony of a complainant who recanted her accusations just 2 weeks ago.
The victim claimed that then 21-year-old Perry and 19-year-old Counts kidnapped her from her home in Queens, then drove her to Central Park, where they took turns sexually assaulting her. The victim recanted after both men had already served their sentences. The alleged victim and the convicted men knew each other at the time.
The complainant now admits that her boyfriend forced her to lie and falsely claim these men sexually assaulted her. Her boyfriend was trying to avoid having to pay a debt to these 2 men.
Perry was released in 2001 on parole. Counts was finally freed on parole last year after spending more than 25 years behind bars.
It's like a really like a torture I went through, and I know I'm sitting in jail for something I didn't do. I didn't do.
After his release, Perry moved to Washington State to start a new life. He is now married with 6 children and owns a landscaping business.
I got a good life now. It's just that it was kind of hard, man. It was real hard, man.
Despite the exoneration, he says this will haunt him for the rest of his life.
It's never going to be over. The reason why, because it tormented my life and it's my past. You understand?
Counts says that it was his faith and family that helped him get through his jail sentence.
I thank God that at the highest level I give my thanks to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I got my family, and my family stood by me all this time through the whole process.
Both men plan to seek restitution. The Innocence Project took on this case in 2014 and had DNA evidence retested. It matched a man who is now deceased, and the victim admits at the time of the alleged assault, she was a prostitute. In Lower Manhattan, Valerie Castro, CBS 2 News.
Van Dyke Perry says he hopes to establish a youth program to mentor children who are at risk of incarceration.
The former UW student accused of sexually assaulting multiple other students will spend 3 years in prison.
Alec Cook's sentence has many disappointed after 11 victims came forward to tell their stories. Amanda Quintana joins us here in the studio with the reaction from the Rape Crisis Center and one of Cook's former teachers. Amanda?
Yes, Cook will spend 3 years in prison, then 8 years on probation for multiple sexual assault, strangulation, suffocation, and stalking. But the Rape Crisis Center's executive director says Cook essentially got off for his crimes because he came from entitlement and wealth. And this could affect the sexual assault victims who are willing to come forward in the future.
These were really horrible, egregious acts of violence against a number of women. They will be healing from this for the rest of their lives. To see the man who did this to them only serve 3 years in confinement, it's a hard thing to overcome.
The community at the Rape Crisis Center feels both defeated and sad to see 22-year-old Alec Cook receive a short sentence, especially after being in the courtroom.
I was shaken to the core over the possibility that I wasn't his only victim.
Reading a victim's statement to the judge.
It's very difficult for victims to do that. We're asking them to live this over and over and over again.
Executive Director Erin Thornley Parisi says although only 6% of offenders serve time, she was hoping the judge would see the need for the justice system to evolve and stand firm against sexual violence.
I think he was basing that on where we were and not where we are now and where we should need to be moving in the future.
Just as disappointed.
I would say his interactions were odd and somewhat inappropriate.
Alec Cook's former human sexuality professor at the UW.
For students who are upset by this, I don't have a good answer. And I think it's not only a question of justice, it's a question of protecting the community.
After Cook went from being one of her students to the discussion topic in her class, she's not confident in 3 years he won't do this again. And for other victims not seeing the justice they think those 11 students who came forward deserve.
There will be some who will say there's just no point. Others might say, you know, maybe my case will be the one.
The Rape Crisis Center will continue their work, they say, even more now to counteract the effects of cases like this one.
Cold water for $2.
This woman don't want to let a little girl sell some water. She calling police on an 8-year-old little girl. You can hide all you want. The whole world gonna see you, boo.
Yeah, and illegally selling water without a permit?
Yeah. On my property.
It's not your property, right?
This woman don't want to let a little girl sell some water. She calling police on an 8-year-old little girl. You can hide all you want. The whole world gonna see you, boo.
Yeah, and illegally selling water without a permit? Yeah.
On my property.
It's not your property.
Something.
What?
Somebody seen the video on Twitter, right? And guess what?
What?
They know you want to go to Disneyland, and they bought you 4 tickets to go...
Of a white woman reportedly calling police on an 8-year-old black girl selling bottled water near AT&T Park, and it is going viral tonight.
This woman don't want to let a little girl sell some water. She calling police on an 8-year-old little girl. You can hide all you want. The whole world gonna see you, boo.
Yeah, and illegally selling water without a permit? Yeah.
On my property.
It's not your property.
This allegedly happened yesterday near the ballpark. Little girl's older cousin posted the video on Twitter with the hashtag PermitPatty. In the 15-second clip, the cousin follows the woman who was walking away talking on the phone. Many are saying it's similar to what happened last month in Oakland when video surfaced of a white woman calling police on a black family for using a charcoal grill at Lake Merritt. That woman was dubbed Barbecue Becky. Now, we reached out to the woman who posted the latest video, and our Andrea Borba will have her story tonight at 11.
We are staying on top of this story that you saw first on 2. A Spring ISD elementary school principal accused of making an inappropriate joke about a special needs student. It's a story that a lot of you have been reading and watching on clicktohouston.com. Channel 2 Sion Rhodes live in Spring now with the latest fallout from that controversial comment. Sion?
And the district does say that the principal said it was just a joke, but it's one that many people don't find funny. In fact, they are calling for that principal to be fired. Principal Shanna Swearingen at work this morning as her school community reels from her controversial comments.
See, that kind of comment is disgusting. Even if it was a joke.
Swearingen reportedly apologizing for remarks she made about a special needs student, a young black boy with behavioral issues who is known to run away from school. Swearingen overheard saying, "We won't chase him. We will call the police and tell them he has a gun so they can come faster." Spring ISD said while the comment was made in jest, it was inappropriate and should never have been made.
That person needs to resign or be fired immediately.
Ashton P. Woods with Black Lives Matter Houston says Swearingen was out of line and out of touch with current concerns about police violence and young black men and boys.
Black children are criminalized far too often. What about all the other children who've died because of a toy gun, right? And you're saying that this child has a gun but doesn't, but actually really needs your help. And that's sad.
I would never even hear her speak like that.
Kathy Rodriguez is a member of the Ponderosa PTA and says while she was shocked to hear what Swearingen said, she still supports her.
You know, she apologized for it. She knows, okay, we all make mistakes. We're human. And we all say things sometimes that we shouldn't say. I think that everyone just needs to just come together as they always have here at Ponderosa.
And I asked the district whether the principal would face any disciplinary action for her comments, a spokesperson telling me that they don't comment on personnel matters.
Do you believe discrimination exists in America today?
I have personally never observed it, but many of my friends from the inner city of across America will tell me that it is evident today.
Do you believe that it exists?
I believe it. Like I said, I have never personally observed it.
I understand you've never, and you're very lucky that you've never experienced it.
That's right.
Do you believe that it exists?
Here's what I would say. I believe the people who tell me that it exists.
So discrimination in America exists today?
I stand by my answer.
I have to say your earlier response to Mr. Capuano was stupefying, even jaw-dropping. I was wondering if you were aware of what happened recently in Charlottesville.
To be honest with you, I don't watch TV.
So you didn't read any of the articles in the newspaper?
I don't read a newspaper.
These are unbelievable statements for any adult in America, especially one that took an oath of office like you did. But let me ask you a couple of questions. So fundamentally, why should the public trust you to overhaul the Community Reinvestment Act, a product of the civil rights movement meant to address generations of segregation and exclusion, if you don't seem really, I mean, you just don't even seem certain that discrimination exists? Will you promise us to move forward on a CRA overhaul only if you have the full support of the civil rights community?
They will be at the table discussing.
I understand they'll be at the table, but some people are at the table and ignored by others at the table. Will you commit to this committee that if there is not unity, if there's not consensus in the civil rights community, you will not move that direction on CRA overhaul?
They will be at the table having discussions like all parties involved in this.
That's the most you're going to commit.
I stand by my answer.
Okay.
There are many people who would say that Joseph Otting spent more time in the inner cities of America than most banking executives across the world.
Yeah, well, you don't have a personal opinion whether there's been any discrimination in banking?
Again, I have not personally observed that.
Mr. Chairman, I yield back. I can't go any further.
Well, that means you probably don't believe a lot of things because you haven't personally experienced nuclear war either. But, you know, so does nuclear war exist? I mean, I'm not going to get into that. That's a ridiculous answer, but that's okay.
I'll respond over to
1860. Yeah! Yeah! Hey! Fucked up!
Headquarters,
shots fired. Come on, buddy. Put your hand now. Show your hands. Give us your fucking hands.